Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Vihare Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhare Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasadi Gaubhaktavrinda Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasadi Gaubhaktavrinda Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasadi Gaubhaktavrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare 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 Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Radha, Rasvi Hari Radha, Rasvi Hari Radha. Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Bhakta Hanuman, Jaya Sita Ram Lakshman Bhakta Hanuman. Jaya Gauranitai, Jaya Gauranitai, Jaya Gauranitai, Jaya Gauranitai. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada. Prabhupada, 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 Prabhupada. Jai Om Vishnupada Paramahamsa Paribrahacharya Stotarstashi Shimadesi Bhaktivedanta Swami Shila Prabhupada Ki. Jai Om Vishnupada Paramahamsa Paribrahacharya Stotarstashi Shimad Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj Shila Prabhupada Ki. Anantakoti Vaishnavrinda Ki. Grantra Shimad Bhagavatam Ki. All glories assembled devotees. All glories assembled devotees. All glories assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Sri Guru and Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Saraswatim Vyasam. Tato Jayamudiraye. Nashta Praesha Bhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Ruttama Sloke Bhaktir Bhavatir Naishtake. We are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Chapter 2, entitled Hiranyakashipu, the King of Demons. Text 32 to 34. There are no purports in 32 and 33. So I will read the sloka and translation, then we will recite 34 sloka. Rudatta Vuchai Dayitam Kripankajam Sanchintyah Shrai Kuchakum Kumarunai Vishrasta Kesha Barana Suchamrinam Srijantya Akrandanaya Vilepire. Translation by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. As the queens loudly cried, their tears glided down their breasts. becoming reddened by kumkuma powder and fell upon the lotus feet of their husband. Their hair became disarrayed, their ornaments fell, and in a way that evoked sympathy from the hearts of others, the queens began lamenting their husband's death. Aho vidatra karune karunanena na prabho bhavan pranito drgago charam dasam usi naranam asivritta dhapura krito dunayena sucham vivardhanah. O Lord, we have now been removed by the cruel providence to a state beyond our sight. You had previously sustained the livelihood of the inhabitants of Usinara, and thus they were happy. But your condition now is the cause of their unhappiness. Text 34. Tvaya kritagena vayam Mahipate katam vina syama surittamena te tatra anuyanam tava vira padayo susrusatinam disha yatra yasyasi. Yasyasi. Tvaya kritagnena vayam mahipate. Tvaya kritagnena vayam mahipate. Katam vinashyama surittamenate. Katam vinashyama surittamenate. Tatranuyanam tava vira padayo. Tatranuyanam tava vira padayo. Susrusatinam disayatra yasyasi. Susrusatinam disayatra yasyasi. Tvaya kritagena vayam mahipate. Katam vinashyama surittamenate. Tatranuyanam tava vira padayo. Susrusatinam disayatra yasyasi. Tvaya kritagena vayam mahipate. Katam vinashyama surittamenate. Tatranuyanam tava vira padayo. Susrusatinam disayatra yasyasi. Katam vinashyama surittamenate. Tranuyanam tava viya padayo. Tutru satinam dishayatrayashashi. Tvaya krutagyena vayam nahi patim. Patam vinashyam. Kāryānāṁ tava vīra pādayo Tusru satīnāṁ viṣayatra yāśaśi Tvaya krutagyena vayam mahīpate Katam vināśyāṁ asuritta menate Tramyanam tava vira padayo Susu satinam nishayam yasya Akutadena vayam maripate Tramuyanam tava vira padayo Susu satinam visayatra yashashi
Matajis? Word for word meanings. Tvayam, you. Kritagena, a most ungrateful personality. Sorry, the most grateful personality. Vayam, we. Mahipate, O King. Katam, how. Vina, without. Syama, shall exist. Surittamena, the best of our friends. Te, of you. Tatra, there. Anuyanam, the following. Tava, of you. Shishirada Ras Vihariji ki. Sita Ram Lakshmanuman ki. Shishigornitai ki. Veera, ho hero. Padayo, of the lotus feet. Sushrusatinam, of those engaging in the service. Disa, please order. Yatra, where? Yasyasi, you will go. Translation. O King, O hero, you are a very grateful husband and the most sincere friend of all of us. How shall we exist without you? O hero, wherever you are going, please direct us. Please direct us there so that we may follow in your footsteps and engage again in your service. Let us go along with you. Purport by His Divine Grace. Formerly, a Kshatriya king was generally the husband of many wives. And after the death of the king, especially in the battlefield, all the queens would agree to accept Sahamarana, dying with the husband who was their life. When Pandu Maharaj, the father of the Pandavas, died, his two wives, namely the mother of Yudhishthira, Bhima and Arjuna, and the mother of Nakula and Sakadev were both ready to die in the fire with their husband. Later, after a compromise was arranged, Kunti stayed alive to care for the little children, and the other wife, Madri, was allowed to die with her husband. This system of Sahamarana continued in India even until the time of British rule, but later it was discouraged, since the attitude of wives generally gradually changed with the advancement of Kali Yuga. Thus, the system of Sahamarana has practically been abolished. Nevertheless, within the past 50 years, I have seen the wife of a medical practitioner voluntarily accept death immediately when her husband died. Both the husband and wife were taken in procession in the mourning cart. Such intense love of a chaste wife for her husband is a special case.
Om Ajnanatim Randasya Jnananjana Salakaya Sakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangam Bhangayate Girim Yat Krupatamaham Vande Sri Gurum Dinatarinam Paramananda Madhavam Sri Krishna Chaitanya Devam Vancha Kalpatarabhyasya Krupa Sindubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prastaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Pastachade Satarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
In this section of Srimad Bhagavatam, it is described how after the death of Hiranyaksha, in the hands of the Supreme Personality in the form of Varaha, his dear brother Hiranyakashipu is on one hand very angry, on another hand he is consoling his mourning family members. Obviously everyone was sad in the family, but we are seeing in this section how Hiranyakashipu is talking like a dhira. He is talking philosophy actually. Philosophy of Bhagavad Gita to some extent. He is in this particular section, Hiranyakashipu is consoling the family members by citing a story from Purana. This itself happened very long time back. He is telling the old story I am going to narrate. That means it is very old, much older. He is giving the story of the king Suyajna of a province called Ushinara province. This king was a very powerful king. He fought on the battlefield for a Kshatriya. To fight in the battlefield is a prestige issue. And even if he has to die, he will happily die than running away from the battlefield, because a Kshatriya dying in the battlefield is normally elevated to the heavenly planet. So there is no loss. Either you enjoy here, that is what Krishna argues in Bhagavad Gita. If you are a Kshatriya, you have got the whole province, you have got so much money, you have got so many. Generally, Prabhupada writes, Kshatriyas used to have more than one wife. To have one wife is a very rare thing, like Lord Ramchandra. Most of the Kshatriyas, they don't take the Ekapatni Vrata. So you can enjoy here, and if you die in the battlefield, you can go and enjoy in the heavenly planet. So enjoyment continues. So they are not very concerned about death in the battlefield, because enjoyment is always assured, either in this life or in the next life. So here, King Suyajna died in the battlefield. Hiranyakashipu is describing how exactly like Hiranyaksha was killed. So here, Suyajna was killed, all the queens were crying. Especially these three slokas of today describes how the queens were so much crying. This happens in every place where the death happens. The close relatives, those who are very attached to the body, they obviously exhibit such kind of emotions, especially the ladies. So they are describing how without Suyajna, their life is something like a void. They cannot imagine of a life without their husband. They think that, how are we going to live? You are taking care of us all the while, and no, now you are not there, and they cannot even imagine of such a situation where they don't have any protection. The husband gives the protection to the wives, so there is no protection now. So they were very concerned about it. So they are even saying here that, let us go along with you to the next life so that we will continue our service. This is very rare case, at least in Kali Yuga. So Prabhupada explains how the queens of a king, when the king is dead, they may accept sahamarana, dying along with the husband, giving up the body. This is also known as sati. The wife feels so much intense pain of the separation of the husband. The person knows that if you have to jump into the fire, the funeral fire, of any fire for that matter, getting into the fire means it is painful. We know that. Every woman will know that also. They must have burned their finger when they are cooking. They know that if little bit, if you put the finger inside the fire, it burns. If you put your whole body, it's going to burn definitely. It's going to be painful. They know it is painful. It's not that they were not aware of the pain and they just entered. No. It's a gradation of pain, so to say. The pain of separation, they find it more severe than the pain of entering into the fire. So they said that better accept a lesser pain than the more severe pain. You can imagine the pain of entering into the fire is considered lesser. That means how much intense pain they may have in separation of their husband. If somebody can have such kind of feeling, they are qualified to commit sati. You have to have such kind of intense feeling, emotions. It's not artificial. It's voluntary process. It's not just somebody who has to force upon. So such women who can feel like that, they are called chaste woman. In the history, there are so many things. The original chaste woman is Sati. We call it Sati because Sati, the daughter of Daksha, wife of Lord Shiva, she actually is self-immolated. You know, she burnt herself because she could not tolerate the pain of her own father committing offense against Lord Shiva. He said that she can't go back because she told her husband that I will go and convince him to invite you, and that didn't happen. And this fellow didn't get convinced also. She is like neither here nor there, nor na gharka na ghatka ho gaya. She said better to leave the body on the very sacrificial arena. She actually sacrificed her own body by yogic power. She burnt her own body. Burning the body means very painful also. Yogic power, you can do it. She burnt it. She is the original example of a chaste woman. Sati. That's why even when anybody commits this, you know, sahamarana, we call it sati. This is original sati. So in this way, Prabhupada here explains in the purport about how the story of Pandu Maharaj, the father of the Pandavas. Similar situation. He had two wives, Kunti and Madri. When he was on hunting excursion in the forest, the Kshatriyas were allowed to do, he saw two deers, you know, trying to enjoy sensual enjoyment. And he didn't know that they are trying to enjoy. He thought there are two deers running here and there. He can't figure it out what they are doing. So naturally he wanted to exercise his, you know, prowess of archery. So he shot the deer. And the deer was not an ordinary deer. It was a rishi in the form of a deer. Kindama Rishi. He took the form of a deer along with his wife, also a she-deer, to enjoy sensual enjoyment. We felt that in the body of a deer, it can be more better enjoyment there in the body of a human being. We don't know. Some or other. And when he was shot, when he died, as he was going to die, he said that, what is this? Why did you do that? He cursed Pandu Maharaj, saying that when you also try to enjoy your wife, in that particular mood when you approach your wife, he will be dead immediately. Cursed him. The power, the rishis, munis, tapasvis, they have a lot of power. This is the power of austerity, by means of which, you know, they can just make anything, whatever they say, to happen. That is satyam. When somebody is, you know, truthful, he gets power. Like that sati, that is also truthfulness, she also gets power. The power of chastity, power of austerity is there for rishi, muni, etc. A woman gets the power by means of chest to her husband. So in this way, Prabhupada explains how in Mahabharata talks about, since Pandu could not approach his wife for enjoyment, then he could not produce children, and Kunti had special mantras to, you know, invite the demigods to come and give her children, by means of which three children, Yudhishthira Maharaj, Bhimsen and Arjuna were born to her. She also lent one more mantra to, there are five mantras, she already used one mantra before marriage anyway. So one mantra to Madri, by means of which Nakul and Sakadev were, you know, born. So this curse, Pandu knew, Madri knew, and Kunti knew, everybody knew, so everybody was cautious, so that this doesn't happen. But then, by some or other, Pandu Maharaj, seasonal change, very nice season, you know, very nice atmosphere for sense enjoyment, what to do? Seasons keep changing and different emotions come out of every living entities. And he, even though he knew that he was going to die, you know, he was somehow or other attracted to his wife Madri, and he was trying to enjoy. Even Madri stopped her, no, don't know the guy. He could not control, by the will of the providence, his senses, and he died. So Prabhupada explains, when he died, both Kunti and Madri, they actually wanted to commit sati. They wanted to, you know, die along with, you know, Pandu. That is actually generally the mood of a chaste woman. And then there are five children. Who will take care? All are small, you know, boys. Who will take care? Then it was agreed that, you know, Kunti will stay back and take care of these children. And no, Madri will commit sati. So in that way, Prabhupada explains how the chaste woman generally used to, you you know, you enter the funeral fire of the husband. So, as I was explaining, there are so many chaste women, Shastra talk about. And they talk about their unparalleled power. It's very powerful. When once the demigods, the god, Trimurtis for that matter, wanted to check the power of chastity of Anasuya, wife of Atri, because they were told, you know, just conduct an examination, test how chaste Anasuya is. So, Lord Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, three of them, they went to the house of Anasuya and they said that they are guests. Anybody guests? Atiti Devo Bhava. Now Devata themselves are guests. Deva and Devaraj, everyone, three of them. He said, what can I do? How can I serve you? So Trimurti said, yes, we want you to serve. Prasad to us, lunch, but we would like you to serve. No, you should be naked and you serve us lunch. You know? Strange enough, sometimes we don't expect the guests come and say that you serve me naked. You know, if somebody does like that, we'll throw the fellow out and actually get out of here. What are you talking about? First of all, we let you in. That is a mistake. Nowadays, they don't even let you in, actually. Kali Yuga, no? You go to any house in Bombay, skyscraper, you know. First of all, you will not be allowed inside the building only. Somehow or other, you enter into the building. Passing through the barriers of security and etc. etc. If you even have come to the flat and you ring the bell, there will be two doors actually, not just one door. Safety. Who knows what you'll do, you know? Open and see. And if you are standing there wanting to distribute your book, they'll say, oh, who is the Dhamma? Close the door. They don't even want to ask you, who are you? What do you want? Nothing. He's a strange guy, we don't even know what he'll do because bhaya. Because insecurity, who will do what? Because so many things are happening around. But that was not the case in ancient times. Those are always open for atithis. Atithi means you don't even know the fellow, actually. It's a guest. You know, you have not met him before. It's not, he's known to you. An unknown fellow, somebody, Atithi Devo Bhava. He's like a demigod is entering in your house like that. Here, Trimurtis, they come and say that, you serve, please, naked. Why? Because a woman cannot be naked in front of anybody other than her own husband. If you are naked in front of anybody's husband, means you are a prostitute. That means no chastity. So, if she refuses, then it is like you are disrespecting the guest, against the dharma. And if you accept it and do it, then your chastity is gone. Tests are always like that. Both will be very difficult. Then you'll have to find a solution, that is intelligence. So, Anasuya was very intelligent. She said, I don't want to refuse the guest, but then I will do something about it. By means of our power of chastity, she made all these three murtis, Lord Brahma, Lord Vishnu, Lord Shiva, as small babies. They became babies actually. A woman naked in front of a small child is not considered anything harmful to the chastity. Children are innocent. Even a grown-up man, if he is innocent, who cannot... Innocent means you cannot discriminate between male and female and try to have a different view about male and female. If you are grown up, you can discriminate. This is male, this is female. It doesn't have to be a small baby. It can be a grown-up person like Sukadeva Goswami. Sukadeva Goswami was walking naked actually himself. Because he didn't discriminate between male and female. He didn't consider he is a male, you know. And he should cover his body so that females cannot look at him. We don't have to follow the footsteps of Sukadeva Goswami in this respect, at least. When he was passing by, young girls were bathing in the pond, naked. He was passing by. When somebody is, somebody is bathing, if somebody discriminates between male and female, you see, Kon Narai, Kaisa Narai, then they will try to cover up, you know. He was like, you know, going. He's not even noticing that somebody is taking bath. So when somebody is not even noticing you, you don't care, you know. He was grown up. They didn't do anything. His father, who was elderly, Vyasadev, he was coming behind Sukadeva, saying, "Hey, Sukadeva, Sukadeva." When he was passing by, all the ladies who, for all these girls, Vyasadeva is like, not only father, maybe grandfather also. He was so elder. They were covering the body. It is explained therein that because Vedavyas was a grahastha and he has to discriminate between male and female. Because he is capable of discriminating between male and female, they thought that we should cover our body. Whereas Sukadev, he was 16 years old, he was young, he is the right age for being attracted towards sense objects. He was not, he was just walking like a madman and they didn't even bother. So that is anything harmful to their chastity. In the same way, Anasuya, with the power of her chastity, made even Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu as babies. You can imagine what kind of power that could be. Helplessly they became babies. They cannot resist her power of chastity. You can always sometimes resist also, you know. Irresistible, beyond resistance. That is power. So, another example of Gandhari we can see in Mahabharata. We have discussed about, Pandu and his wife committing sati. His own brother, Dhritarashtra, after being chastised by Vidura, that you are living like a dog, Do something about your spiritual thing. And when he left, went to the forest, his wife Gandhari is also a chaste woman. When Gandhari was to marry Dhritarashtra, when Dhritarashtra was blind, she voluntarily covered her eyes, throat, voluntarily covered her eyes. Because a chaste woman takes always a humbler position in front of the husband. If you are not able to see, if I see the world, I may become a little bit more proud, so let me also not see. Cover. When she wanted to give some special power to Duryodhana, she said that, okay, Duryodhana, please, tomorrow morning you come completely naked in front of me. I will, I have not seen anything actually, but I will look at you. When I see you, then I will make your body as good as iron, steel. She wanted to make his body steel, but before that itself, his heart was steel anyway. The only remaining of the body, she said, well, we will make the body also, your heart is already steel. Let us make your body also like steel. He said, okay. Then comes our own Krishna. He said, kya? I said, bana dekhta kya hoga? If you are invincible, you have to die, Baba. And you are adharmi, he already decided how he has to die also. If everything made like steel, how it is possible? Then Krishna Leela starts there. Krishna comes and says, are kidhar ja rahe? I'm going to meet my mummy. Are you mad? What is this? No, she told me to come like this, Baba. What? She must have told, but you should have some intelligence, Kuch dimag nahi. She said, not verbally, Baba, she said you come like that, but then at least you should cover your private parts, How can you do like this? Krishna can do that. Krishna can convince even Duryodhana to do that. That makes sense. You know? Yeah, that makes sense. So, we know that Duryodhana covered his private parts when Gandhari opened the eyes, she looked at him and he made the entire body whichever visible to her sight still, but then he was covering. He said, "What is this? Why did you cover? I told you not to cover, you know." He said, no, Krishna came and she said, "Tige." If Krishna had said like that, means then there is no hope for any modification of the plan. Krishna's plan prevailed. There is nothing that we can do about it. We have to helplessly be part of the plan. That is intelligence, another intelligence actually. This is the power of Archa. This is what? Anybody can look at anybody else and make an iron body? No. It's the power of the chastity. The power of the chastity, she can do that. She never opened her eyes before. And she also, when Dhritarashtra left the forest and he was doing Ashtanga Yoga practice and tapasya, and at the end, he actually also by means of his yogic power burnt his own body along with the cottage that he was in. Gandhari also entered the fire, said that, what will I do without my husband? And after that, Vidura was very happy. Yes, they have attained their destination. So in this way, in this section, we are discussing about, there are so many cases, we may not go into details of all the wonderful satis of the history that we have, but then, it is described by Chanakya Pandit about beauty, different kinds of beauty. Chanakya Pandit talks. The beauty of the cuckoo bird, the bird's beauty, is its voice. It's very sweetly, cuckoo. Sometimes, these jugus, there are a lot of birds also. They make sound, very sweet sound. It's like an alarm bell without disturbing too much, you see. The birds, they start making sound. This is nature's arrangement, nature's alarm. They get up before you and they wake you up with a sweet sound. This is like a royal wake up. When the king goes to sleep, when he has to get up, nobody will go and knock the door. You can't do that. Or you can't put the alarm bell. There are royal musicians. When the king has to get up, they'll start the music very, sweet and slow, so that it is like a gradual process. Slowly you'll hear. It's like royal wake up. Waking up also is royal, actually. You can't just go and knock door and make him like this, Like that, nature has arranged royal wake up for everybody, but then those who cannot wake up are those sound. They need an alarm bell. Then we need a kirtan played with a loud voice, then one can get up in the ashram. The beauty of the cuckoo bird, Chanakya Pandit says, is his voice. And the beauty of the woman is not the external beauty, the beauty is the chastity, Chanakya Pandit says. A woman may not look so good for normal terms, but if the woman is chaste, that is actual beauty, Chanakya Pandit says. If a person is ugly, also if he is a knowledgeable person, that is his beauty. Knowledge of the man is the beauty of the person, not just how he appears like. Knowledge means, the Prabhupada explains several places, Shastra says, a person will be known when he opens his mouth. If you close your mouth, what you know, we don't know. When you open your mouth, we know what you know. Knowledge. And the power, the beauty of ascetic, a sadhu, is his forgiveness. If the sadhu is having the quality of forgiveness, that is his beauty. Punishing, there is no big deal, but forgiving is a different thing altogether. So, it is like ornament of a devotee. We talk about the humility. Humility is the ornament of a devotee. Like that, for a woman, the ornament, the most valuable ornament, you may have so many ornaments, earrings, nose rings, this ring, so many things, necklace, etc. They're not real ornament. If the ornament of chastity is missing, all the other ornaments have no value. So, as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is describing about how to become humble. Tranadapi sunichena taroryeva sagasnuna amanena manadena kirtanaya sadahari. If one can actually do that, you know, he can always chant Hare Krishna, right? This is three-step formula for becoming humble, humility. So you will find a chaste woman also manifesting these qualities. More humbler than the blade of grass. In front of the husband, she always considered herself to be a blade of grass. Humble. More tolerant than the tree, you know, even if the husband is, you know, cruel. Still, she considers herself to be, you know, servant. More humbler than, you know, the grass and more tolerant. Tolerance, without tolerance you will not find any quality of all these cases that we are discussing about. It's a extraordinary degree of tolerance, not more tolerant than the tree also. Whether anybody can be tolerant than the tree, yes, all these great personalities, great devotees and chaste women, they actually fit into that bill. They fit into that. Amanena manadena. Giving respect, not expecting respect. You can find they actually, these are the qualities, you know, exhibited by chaste women, because of which they actually get the power of chastity. So, in this way, as we said, if one can actually be really following the steps of this instruction by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, one can actually be a devotee, a real devotee to say. So much so that he'll be always Krishna conscious. Kirtanaya Sadahari means he's always glorifying Supreme Personality of Godhead. That's a pure devotee of the Lord. So, exactly like a chaste woman considers her husband as Swami. Swami is like master. Master. No other master. When she does that, she gets a tremendous power and she also gets the same destination as the husband. For example, when she enters into the fire, funeral fire, she definitely gets the same destination as the husband. In the purport, Srila Prabhupada explains, this system is actually voluntary. And even it was there during the British time, Prabhupada says. British time is pre-1947. Prabhupada says even 50 years from his time, that means, you know, maybe something around 1930s. 1920s, 50 years before, you know, whatever Prabhupada wrote this purport, Prabhupada explains, there was a doctor, medical practitioner, when he died, his wife committed sati. This is very much in Kali Yuga, 20th century we are talking about, 1920s. Prabhupada gives this example from his own personal experience. And all these cases are actually voluntary. But then, sometimes, even if the wife is not having such kind of feeling that without my husband I cannot exist, he says, oh, jayega to humko kya karna hai? Jao. If such feeling is there, there is no need to commit sati actually. There is no need actually. But sometimes, family members want to think that, hey, if you commit sati, our family will be known as the family of sati, you fall down. Hey? I have to fall down and you will be known as the family of sati. You don't want to, if somebody doesn't even want to commit sati, if she is forcefully thrown into the fire, that is crime. That is no value to it. It's just crime. It is, you know, killing a person, throwing into the fire actually. So, Prabhupada says, such kind of intense love for a chaste woman is very rare and it is not practical also. Anyway, by seeing all these things, the government has already formed a law act called Prevention of Sati Act. So if you commit sati or if you push somebody, you'll be put in the jail now. Anyway, what we can learn from these slokas here is exactly like a chaste woman, how she can consider only her husband is the only master. And when she does such an intense service for him, she actually gets the destination of her husband by doing so. Exactly in the same way, there is also chastity of a devotee. Considering Krishna to be the only personality of Godhead to be worshipped. Nobody else is my Swami. He is also Swami. He is master. When one considers Krishna as the only master, only worshipable master, nobody else, be it anybody, name it, no, starting from Brahma, Shiva, etc., etc., no. That is also a kind of chastity. Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam. Ekam means Krishna says me only. So if you consider he only to be surrendered, he only is my master, that is the chastity of devotion. No, he is very chaste. He's a very chaste devotee. Means he doesn't accept anybody else other than Krishna as his master. Under any circumstances. Even if anybody comes and tests him out, like Anasuya was tested, you know, he will Krishna will give the intelligence how to react to that situation. Even if you don't have it. If you really are all the time surrendered to Krishna, Krishna will give the intelligence. So in this way, we hear from Hiranyakashipu the wonderful story of how to be chaste, especially for that age, and how powerful it was, and by doing so, how we can also have such kind of feeling, so that in our own devotional service, we can achieve the perfect. When the chaste woman, when she pleases the husband, husband becomes pleased and he benedicts also. In the same way, if we can please Lord Krishna as a chaste devotee, Krishna says, see, this person has no other shelter. He cannot go anywhere and Krishna becomes the shelter. So by being a chaste devotee, we can completely take shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna and we can go back home, back to Godhead to continue our service to Krishna. A chaste woman also, she, here it says, life after life we will continue service. So, a chaste woman attains the same destination the next lifetime also. She continues her service to her husband the next lifetime. So, in the same way, if we are chaste to Lord Krishna, we continue our service not just anywhere, right in Goloka Vrindavan. Eternally serving, not just one lifetime, another lifetime. Eternal. So, if Krishna is our eternal Swami, so we render our eternal service to Him so that we can continue our service in the transcendental world. We stop here. Any questions or comments? Dheer Lalit Govind Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
You have explained very nicely, but I have still the previous day, the women, when you want to make the separation from the husband, is a very severe than the burning the body. But nowadays the government is already banned the sati practice. But still, some women don't want to separate from the husband and the last moment. They cannot do it. You are saying it, do the Krishna seva, but I think still you have to put some more light on this, because we can explain to all the everyone's based on that, please.
Prabhupada has taught us how to be chaste to Lord Krishna. Prabhupada never recommended any different kinds of karma kanda thing. Different kinds of demigod worship, elaborate demigod worship for pleasing separately the demigod so that we can have some material, things so that we can be happy in that. Prabhupada has given already, following the footsteps of his Guru Maharaj, following the footsteps of Acharyas, all Acharyas always insist upon how to be chaste to the Supreme Lord. Be it Ramanuja, be it Madhva, be it any Acharya, strict. So, being chaste means fully surrendered. Without surrender, there is no chastity. A chaste woman is fully surrendered to the husband. The husband will say that you jump, she will jump. She will not ask question why. But husband should also know that why to make a person to jump. That's a different thing altogether. You can't be crazily giving instructions. If God says you jump, you know, if Krishna comes and tells you jump from there, you can actually jump. There is no harm in it. Because Krishna has already thought about all the consequences of jumping from the building. And he found out that this is the best solution for you, then you can take. But if one can act on the platform of Krishna, knowing all the consequences and at your best welfare, if you can tell, you can execute. But the conditioned soul cannot do it. He can't understand. He can only think about what is good for him. Okay, if he jumps, he'll be eliminated, I'll be happy. Such kind of nonsense fellow, if he comes and go and tell you jump, you reject it immediately. There's no meaning to it. So, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And his service is the only thing that is going to save us. To be born again and again in this material world. So unless this is done, there is no question of going back home, back to Godhead. The first principle of devotion starts with Saranagati. In Sri Sampradaya, they say that first thing is Saranagati. Then we'll talk about what devotion you can do. Without surrender, all the devotion is mixed devotion. Okay, thoda to kar raha hu, maybe kar raha hu, phir bhi theek hai. We are missionary institution. So we are engaging people. We are telling them to surrender. Don't think that, you know, you have preached to somebody and he agreed to follow four regulative principles. He started his beat bag chanting 16 round and he shaved up his head, started putting dhoti kurta and he's staying in the temple. Prabhu, he has surrendered. First step. Both steps are. It's only the first step. There are so many lot more steps. So the real surrender means a person cannot imagine of doing anything other than serving Krishna under all circumstances. That level when it comes, then it is full surrender. So we are encouraging people, even if your first step surrender, no problem. So you be here and keep doing things. You may be doing politics, you may be doing diplomacy, you may be doing nonsense. Still you be here and serve Krishna so that it will be purified slowly, slowly, slowly. And then you can come to the level of fully surrendered. A fully surrendered devotee is all pure devotees, 100%. There is nothing that you can imagine of doing that displeases Krishna. And nothing you can imagine of not doing something pleases Krishna. So, Krishna consciousness movement as a missionary. We are missionary. You know, we are trying to make people Krishna conscious. Irrespective of their qualification. Some people are not even qualified. Some people may not be fit to stay in the temple also. Prabhupada giving opportunity. Chalo, rahe. Kam se kam sudharega kuch din mein. Phir bhi sudharta nahi hai, kya bolega abhi. Hope against the hope. One fine day we will improve. So, devotees, they should always think how to more and more become surrendered to Krishna. The symptom of surrender is how much you are doing it for Krishna and how much you are doing it for yourself. How much you are doing it for Krishna tending to 100. How much you are doing to yourself tending to 0. That is surrender. Sometimes this is tending in 60%, 30%. Chalta hai. Chalta hai. But then we should not be satisfied there. How to go further? I am in the temple, you know. I am better than the outside fellow. See, that fellow is eating meat. I am not eating meat. That fellow is drinking. I am not drinking. See, I am better. I am happy. It's okay. That is not the end. It is only the beginning. It was beginning, eh? Simply you follow four regulative principles, chant Hare Krishna. You think you can go back to Godhead without purifying your consciousness? The qualification to go back to Godhead means your consciousness is 100% pure. You can see yourself how much pure your consciousness is. We don't have to make comments on that. So one has to be interested how much to purify. Purification and surrender, they are interrelated. More you are surrendered, more purification. So this Krishna consciousness movement is giving wonderful opportunity and we should use the opportunity as much as possible. Don't be very satisfied with how much progress you made. Be dissatisfied with what progress you have not made. That will make you to progress further. No, I am happy, you know, everything is fine. I am better than my family members. None of my family members chant Hare Krishna. I am chanting, you know. Not enough. It's only first step you have taken. If suppose you have to climb a big hill, and first step, see, so many people are not even come to the hill. I am at least at the foothill of the hill. How long you will be happy with that? Krishna is waiting for you on top of the hill, and he sat down on the first step of the hill and said that I am happy, better I am at the hill, you know. So, idhar thoda dhoop bhi nahi hai, thoda chaya bhi hai. Dekho, they are suffering. Material world, see, karmis are suffering, jnanis are suffering, everybody is suffering, I am happy. Krishna will be happy if you climb the hill further. Because it gives happiness to Krishna, at least for Krishna's sake I should climb. Then he will be all right. That is expected. That is expected. But this process of Krishna consciousness is so powerful. If you are sincere and serious, it's a natural consequence. It's natural, automatically it will happen. You have to be sincere and serious. If one is not sincere, one is not serious, he thinks that, you know, he can be an imposter here. You can cheat everybody in the entire world, you can't cheat this person standing and playing flute. So whom are we trying to convince? We should convince Krishna. Convincing everybody else is no big deal. Because all conditioned soul can be easily convinced of our drama. Krishna will not be convinced of our drama. We have to do real things with Krishna. That is expected. That is what Prabhupada is expecting of us. If we can do that, that will be pleasing to Prabhupada. That will be pleasing to Krishna. That is the success of our life. Hanuman Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Hare Bol. Hare Krishna.
Hanuman Prabhuji is your senior Prabhuji. And he raised his hand. I saw that. That is more important. Next is you.
Okay.
You sit there only. Next is your question. Sit in the chair. Take your honorable seat.
Hare Krishna. I have comment on this subject that Krishna do not like the be a proud or pride of the devotees, that he is not satisfied. So once Narada Rishi went to Vaikuntha, Kailas and Brahmaloka, and he was glorifying the Anusaya in front of the demigods. So they appreciate
who?
The Lakshmi, Saraswati and Parvati. They say his woman is born in earthly planets, how she can be greater than us? Then requested to take an examination. So for that purpose, Lord Vishnu, Lord Brahman, Lord Shiva came and to examine. In the exam they asked, feed us as a naked. So by her power, she made them a child, small children. But children looking same faces, looking same. Then later on, Narada Rishi went and approached the demigods and they were very problem that not come return, Brahma, Vishnu and Lord Shiva. So say, when they will come? Then Narada Rishi said, now they are children. They will grow up and we take too much time. So then what to do? He said, you go and beg from Anusaya to get your husbands back. When they came to Anusaya, Anusaya said, I will give, but you recognize who is your husband. Then they failed to recognize. Then they requested, please give her husband by your kindness. And Anusaya returned to them their husband in one condition, that they will have to become of her son as a Dattatreya. So Lord Brahma, Lord Vishnu and Lord Shiva all together, this form of Dattatreya.
Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Yes.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, you describe about the beauty of kakus, the beauty of an ugly person and the beauty of a sadhus. Later on you said that the beauty of a sadhu is humbleness. So how one can or how a devotee can become humble? Like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu mentioned in Trinada Vishunis, you know, one can become humble more than the grass. So what is the process to become humble?
Process is given by Prabhupada. chant Hare Krishna. Chant Hare Krishna and be happy. There is nothing, no special process we are going to give. Follow the footsteps of the Acharyas. We are chanting, but we are not chanting as much as it should be in the quality. How to increase the quality? If you are chanting Hare Krishna in quality, this is a natural, becoming humble is a natural consequence of chanting Hare Krishna. You may say that everybody chanting Hare Krishna is not happening. Thoda to gadbade chanting. There is no problem with the mantra, problem with our chanting. So if we chant properly, attentively, offenselessly, it's a natural consequence. Other day we were discussing the same thing. Haridas Thakur was the emblem of chanting. We say that Namacharya. Even though he was beaten in the marketplaces, you know, he didn't find any fault with them. That is the symptom of more tolerant than a tree. Tree is not going to pray, you know, saying that please forgive them. Tree is just keeping quiet. There's, you go one step ahead and pray for the welfare of the person who is actually punishing. It's one step higher than being tolerant. So process is known to everybody actually. It is not, there is no secret here. It is known to everybody, but then implementing is the problem. Attentive chanting, offenseless chanting, not to commit offense. We know all the 10 offenses also. Everything we know actually. It's all about how to put it in practice. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu talks about everything, what we are expected to be doing. It is there. It's a question of putting in practice. But putting in practice is a very difficult thing. That is, preaching is very easy, practicing is difficult. Simple. For me to sit in this Vyasasana and preach, to, you know, to give this Bhagavatam class is actually easier thing than putting all those things I am talking about in my own life also. What to do? Try. Kya karne ka bhi? Suppose, if I am telling that more humbler than the tree, you may ask me, are you more humbler than the blade of grass? No! What you are doing then? I'm trying. Aur kya karega? Should try. Are you more tolerant than the tree? No. Then why are you talking about that? Unless I talk about it, how do I know and remind myself? Then I know that, on that day I spoke in Bhagavatam class, so I should be a little bit more tolerant. Kam se kam ho to aayega. Is it trying again, hoping against the hope actually? There is no other way. There is no shortcut. You are not going to get something very special one day and then you go back to Godhead. No, it's a gradual process and it has to happen. Everybody is trying. Somebody again, somebody piche. That's the only difference. How to become more humble? Chant Hare Krishna sincerely. Hare bhai, I am committing offenses. When will I stop committing offenses? I'm knowingly committing. Am I taking any steps to avoid that offenses? Somebody is coming and telling, Hare Prabhu, you are committing offense. Suppose somebody is coming and telling, Prabhu, you spoke to that devotee, you know, very harshly. Actually, it looks like a Vaishnava aparad. Maybe just this is my humble request. He came and told, what to do now? We can say on one hand, oh, thank you very much, Prabhu, I will try to avoid. Possible. It's one option. Another option is, what is your problem? Mind your own business. Can do that also. Another option, you may even tell him, Prabhu, the way you are coming and speaking to me, this is actually offense, not that one. It all depends upon what how you interact with the situation. You can do anything you want to do. It's your life and you have all your things to do. So it depends upon whether you want to go forward or go backward. It all in you. So if one is sincere and serious, follow the teachings of Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada has given everything for you to go back home, back to God. You don't need anything else. It's all there. How to implement that in our life is the only thing remaining. If that can happen, you are ready to go back to God. So to become humble means chant Hare Krishna sincerely, seriously. think that, Hare, I am not able to make progress. I am chanting for 25 years. How much I made progress, not happening. What is happening around? Because how much left in our life, we don't know actually. We have to be serious. How can I finish Krishna consciousness in this lifetime, not put it for future lifetime? If one is having such kind of intense desire for going back home, back to Godhead. Dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. Krishna is there to help you. If you are sincere, he will help you. If you are not sincere, why he will bother himself? Because if Krishna comes and tells you to become humble, he is concerned that you may tell him, mind your own business, what he will do. Actually, it is his business, but still. Sincere and serious practice of Krishna consciousness. Two brothers are raising hand in one line. Okay, first start with the younger one.
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, woman should be chaste. So, suppose if her husband is a sinful person, so you said that in the lecture that if whatever destination the husband receives, the woman also receives after sati. So if suppose a husband is a sinful person and he attains some lower planets, then that chaste woman also should go to the lower planets. And what happens to her devotional life if she is a devotee?
If husband is sinful, what happens to the chaste wife? So, generally what is expected is, if a woman has to, her dharma is to be chaste, right? A man is supposed to be doing his swadharma also. We can't be, mismatch between these two. But that dharma could be different. This is in the Varnashrama system. A person is expected to be doing his swadharma. Krishna says, Arjuna, no, you are a kshatriya, do your swadharma. So he's supposed to be doing his swadharma. So the question is, if he is not doing the swadharma, then what will the chastity of the wife lead to? It's a very interesting thing. And we have no incidences in the scripture. We can try to guess, speculate, several things are available. But then, to be on the safe side, it is expected that the husband has to be following his dharma, then only the wife's dharma will take the effect. If the husband is not doing his own dharma, wife may be sincere, she may get her benefit, but then it's very, very, it's not very clear, so to say. Can we leave there or should we speculate more? We don't have to speculate more, leave it there. Basically, the husband is expected to be doing dharma for the wife to be doing the dharma of chastity. But there are many cases of test on chastity. At the time, it may appear like, something abnormal cases. Several cases are there. But generally, it is expected that the husband is supposed to be doing his dharma. Women is a devotee. These are all we are talking about, not for devotees. Devotees, everybody is Swami, is Krishna only. Krishna is the super Swami. He is a Swami for everyone. In the devotees, husband, wife may be there, but then ultimately Krishna is the supreme shelter. Krishna is the supreme personality of God, or to whom we should be chaste to. Husband has to be chaste to Krishna. Then wife can be chaste to Krishna through husband. Aisa bhi hota hai. She cannot say that Krishna is Supreme Lord, my husband is nothing, husband jao. Wo bhi gadbad ho jayega. Thoda balance to karna padega. Husband, if he is a devotee, what's the problem of the wife serving the husband? Krishna will be pleased when he sees that his servant is being served. So directly if he want to go, usme bhi thoda gadbad ho jayega. You have to make a balance depending upon your social position, devotional position, etc.
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, the slok comes in the Bhagavatam as a Hiranyakashipu telling the story.
Yes.
So Hiranyakashipu here, you told that he is talking about the Bhagavad Gita.
Teachings of Bhagavad Gita.
Teachings of Bhagavad Gita. Then what?
Some teachings of Bhagavad Gita.
What happened to him?
He is not going to talk about surrender unto me. He is only talking about second chapter.
Only second chapter. So he didn't know the other chapters of the Bhagavad
Gita. See, the problem is knowing is one thing and doing is another thing. You can conveniently keep it aside also. You may know it, you have to surrender. Ab thoda baad mein karega, abhi kya jaldi jaldi karke kya karna? Bahut time hai hamare paas. Malum nahi kitna time hai. But he was definitely on the bodily platform. So, you know, he was even though he is speaking philosophy, he was burning inside. How to get rid of the person who got rid of my brother? He was speaking sweetly outside, but he was very angry inside. So, generally, demons actually know some level of shastra, But then when it comes to implementation, they act on the bodily platform. Selfish interest. What is good for them and their family? Aham mameti, this is me. This is all my family members. What is good. He was very upset with Vishnu because he is helping the demigods. He is not helping me. And my family is my enemy. Bodily platform. They act at the bodily platform.
This means that whatever is in their interest, they just take it from it. Yes. The Shastra. Whatever it is.
Sometimes we do, you know. Prabhupada said, Prabhu, that's why I am doing. Where Prabhupada said and what is the context? Nothing. You just say what Prabhupada said. What Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. And you say something. What is convenient for, that is what all the interpreters are doing. Whatever convenient for you, you take one that, I am following Bhagavad Gita. What? Only one sentence? What about the whole Bhagavad Gita? Let's see the whole Bhagavad Gita as one thing, you know. What is the final conclusion of Bhagavad Gita? That if you follow, that's fine. You say that, you know, Hiranyakashipu can also say that, you know, he's talking about soul, body and all. He can always say that I am following Bhagavad Gita. What about 18th chapter? Second chapter mein baith karke bolta hai, I am following Bhagavad Gita. No, you have to see the overall thing, then you are really following Bhagavad Gita. You can't twist a statement out of the context and try to say that I am following. Doesn't work like that. So even though, you see, Hiranyakashipu, Ravana, Ravana was also very learned actually. He learned. But then, no, it's a bad intelligence. Using those things for one's own selfish interest. That is where they get stuck. We should not become Hiranyakashipu and Ravana. That we'll have to make sure. Some portion of teaching you take and then say that everything is, no. Everything has to be followed.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna. Yeah. Where is it going? Oh. Yes.
Krishna Bhaji, thank you for such a nice explanation. I want one clarification or little explanation. Like in Prabhupada mentioned in the fourth canto in the context of Prithu Maharaj that when he took rule from the Brahmanas, gave the rule and he followed the principle such wonderfully, such nicely that he actually delivered his father who was very sinful. So there, that is one point Prabhupada makes, that one can do the principles nicely and he can actually deliver other people who are dependent or who are senior or father like him. But there Prabhupada actually takes a very humbler position. He says that we are making disciples all over the world for only one reason, that even if one person becomes a pure devotee and goes back home back to Godhead, so he will even take me to back home back to Godhead. Prabhupada is a Paramhamsa, actually we know. So, but I want a bit detailed, more explanation, what actually Prabhupada even wants to say in that concept.
I cannot talk on behalf of Prabhupada, what is his mood. If you ask me, I can tell what is my mood, because
Actually, what is my vow. I don't have any understanding, so you can tell little
Prabhupada, we cannot understand Prabhupada's mood. You already said, you know, he is taking a very, so, you know, he is just, you know, the example of the, you know, Tranadapi Sunichena Taroreva Sagasnu Namane Namanadena Kirtaniya Sadahari. You can just see that. Prabhupada writes in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita, he writes in the preface. Even if one person becomes a devotee, our mission is successful. Prabhupada writes. In preface, Prabhupada writes. He is saying even one person becomes a devotee, no? One person becomes a pure devotee, we will consider our mission to be successful. So, this is the symptom of humility. He's not telling that, you know, how many disciples I made, you know, see my disciples are this many, you know, I must be a very powerful Jagat Guru. The more you mature, the more humble you become. Simply like a paddy. Even the paddy can teach you something. The paddy, when it grows like this. Those who are from villages where paddy fields are there, you know. Those who have not seen paddy, you may have to go to Talasari after some time. But now they are sowing the seed, you go after 3-4 months. The paddy, when it starts growing, it grows like this. When grains are there, and still it will be like this. When the grains become heavier and then become more mature, then it becomes like this. Isn't it? So the way you react will be known as how much mature you are. There's a saying that if your pot is completely full and you carry it on your head, it won't make much noise. Again, you'll have to go to Talasari. Field trip. But you take the same pot, you fill it off, and then you walk. All kinds of sound will come. There's a saying that off pot makes more noise than the fully filled pot. Jada avaj karta hai. Jo jada avaj karta matlab hai, theek hai, tumhara level utna hi hai. Kya karega? We hope that it will get filled more and more, that's all. So Prabhupada, when he says like that, it shows the degree of his humility, that's all I can say. I can't go more further to speculate about what Prabhupada would have thought about it, not necessary. Someone raised your hand here.
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, as you said that we should be chased to God. So how my question is that how we can know that Krishna want me to do what? Means what to do?
He has already said in Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Saranam Vraja. It is for you. Don't think it is for everybody else except you. It is for you.
But my condition are different from, means what, when he said that, I mean, I'm in
this
different...
This statement is an eternally truthful statement. There is no change in this. I said, no, Bhagavad Gita version 2, Sarva Dharma Parityajya will be changed to something else. Sab dharmas rekho aapka paas karke koi version nahi hai. Krishna's statement is eternally true. It was true even before Krishna made the statement. Try to understand. That doesn't mean that nobody else was surrendering to him and he made a statement, people started surrendering unto him. No, it was Krishna's statement is eternally true from the very beginning of creation till the destruction also. This statement, there is not going to be any change. Because it is eternally true, it is applicable to every one of us. Please try to understand, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mam Ekam Saranam Vraja is not just for Arjuna. It is not just for Arjuna. It is for every single living entity. It is even meant for the dog, but it doesn't understand. Theek hai jaane do. But at least you understand who we are telling you to surrender. We are not going to preach to dogs and surrender and take them into the Brahmacharya Ashram here. It is applicable even for the dogs and trees and every living entity. But they cannot surrender like you surrender. That's why we are telling you to surrender. Everybody is applicable eternally. No change. As it is, no change. Okay, anything special comments? We are late already. We'll stop here. Thank you very much for your consideration. ग्रंथराय श्रीमद् भागवतम की शील प्रभुपाद की निताय गौरव प्रेमानंदे।